increased instruments in the Verdi Il Trovatore. We had piccolo, and then we had kind of a full battery, shall we say, of percussion. You had a triangle and a bass drum, also the timpani as usual. Oh, and let's not forget the cimbassa, which is kind of this strange cross between a trombone and a tuba. Moving on to just other aspects of these works, Alfredo, the leading man in La Traviata, was portrayed by Placido Domingo, who's still around. He was the friend and rival. He is the friend and former rival, shall we say, of Luciano Pavarotti, who's passed away. And I think, as I mentioned, Placido has fallen on slightly hard times, which we talked about in class. And then finally, with Aida, you have an example of the banda, of live instruments on stage. I don't think we actually saw that, but in the score, Verdi specifies unspecified band instruments to be part of the procession. And of course, we also saw horses, elephants have been in the cast at times, and it is an example, clearly, of grand opera, over-the-top romanticism, which is just a spectacle. The whole scene hardly moves the story around along, but there it is. And it's also not really the first, but the first we've heard of exoticism moving to musical values, or at least trying to evoke musical values outside of Western Europe. Here we are in the Middle East, purportedly ancient Egypt. And what goes around comes around. The guy that played the trumpet of Tutankhamun in the recording probably knew this music and was probably thinking of this when he was himself trying to evoke ancient Egyptian music, so go figure once more. And of course, with that basically balletic music that we heard from Aida, we really have a total work of art, which reminds us of Verdi's arch rival Wagner doing his music dramas, which he characterized as Gesamt und Kunstwerke, the total work of art. And if you recall, he had this crazy patron, crazy King Ludwig, who supported his endeavors. Wagner is not a very nice guy. Anti-Semitic. He steals his best friend's wife. Crazy. Oh, and his wife, at least the second wife, is the daughter of Liszt. And Liszt is about his exact contemporary. So there's another thing to keep in mind. But at any rate, Wagner builds his own opera house. Custom made, he puts the orchestra down in a covered pit so that the orchestra does not get in the way of the drama. And for my money, I'd rather see the orchestra, because that's my total work of art, what can I say? The constantly evolving leitmotifs up top, the singer's just kind of riding along with recitative, and we've got to maybe get a little more context than just the Ride of the Valkyrie from Die Valkyrie, the second of the four Ring of the Nibelung operas. So we're going to have three excerpts plus a fourth, which was a piece that he did on a break. So let's take this sequentially. First, Das Rheingold, the gold from the Rhine. And this is the example of Wagner, who can be very complex harmonically, can also be very simple. And you've sort of heard that in our excerpt from Die Walküre. In this case, the depiction of the Rhine River is one giant E-flat major chord that just evolves. And it's very close to minimalism, a late 20th century style. We'll hear that as reused in the movie The New World, and in this case it's used as Captain John Smith in prison chains is coming up the Potomac River. He's on his way to eventually meet Pocahontas, and no, it's not Elizabeth Warren. At any rate, after that, a reusage, since we're kind of on this reusage movie take, from Apocalypse Now, the use of music to scare the hell out of the enemy, which of course goes back to ancient times. Whoever's got the loudest trumpet wins. And in this case, good soldier boys from the U.S., busting the Vietnamese by blasting Wagner over the stereo in the helicopter choppers. Evidently, Wagner got so exhausted writing those two operas, of the first two of The Ring of the Nibelung, that he decided to take a break after that. Oh, and he always wrote his own libretti, as opposed to Verdi, who always had professional writers. And Wagner's practice, totally different than mine, by the way, was to write a complete libretto and then write the music, rather than a kind of an evolutionary thing. At any rate, he stops The Ring of the Nibelung, starts another German subject from antiquity, the story of Tristan and Isolde, boy meets girl, but boy and girl hate each other because girl is off to a political marriage that boy is arranging with boy's best friend. Got it? There's a Star Trek episode that's right along these lines, by the way. And the maid slips him a Mickey love potion. They fall madly in love. And in Tristan and Isolde, this overture, or sorry, prelude, heaven forbid, is the definitive progressive harmony of Wagner. It is so chromatic, you get lost. And in a sense, it's evolving waves of chromaticism that don't resolve we expect, constant modulation, and it's almost, as Leonard Bernstein would say, a three-hour orgasm waiting to happen. Finally, ah, and of course they die, but that's the way it goes. And then finally, an excerpt at the end from Gotterdammerung, that damnation twilight of the gods, where the gold from the Rhine is finally recast back into the Rhine women, into the Rhine river, to the Rhine maidens once again. Okay, here we goes, and see you a little bit after all these excerpts.
Dear Mother, you fill the land with your beauty. You reach to the end of the world. How shall I seek you? Show me your face.